You ever wonder what happens to big rock stars after they're done rocking out for the masses? Well, there's one particular rock and roll legend we wanted to know what he's been up to for all these years. It was pretty easy to find him, because, after all, he is the most popular substitute teacher at our school.
My name is Walter Egan, and I am a musician, songwriter, singer, recording artist, substitute teacher. There's nothing more that I could say now. I'm an only child. I grew up in New York City, and I have a twin cousin. We are 15 minutes apart, born in the same hospital, delivered by the same doctor. So we've grown up kind of as brothers, and about the time we were 14, Cousin Jim, as we call him, got a banjo, and so I had to get a guitar to keep up with him. And the way that that occurred was it was actually the summer, my 15th birthday is in the middle of the summer. Well, all my birthdays are in the middle of the summer. Anyway, I was on vacation with my parents, and we were staying in Nantucket Island off the coast of Massachusetts. And I hated the fact that I had to hang for a week with my parents. And so I stayed in the cottage by myself when they went out and toured the island. And there was an upright piano in the cottage, and I sat there picking out melodies of songs on the piano. And they came back while I was doing that, and they said, you know, oh my gosh, you're a prodigy. We'll get you a piano. And I didn't really want to play the piano. I said, no, I want a guitar. So I got a guitar for my 15th birthday, and I decided against, well, I asked not to get lessons along with that. I got a songbook of a group that I knew the music of, which was the Kingston Trio. And so I taught myself to play by looking at this songbook and learning how to make the chords, and then picking up what I could from watching other guitar players. And in high school, my best friend John Zambetti had a band called the Malibus, and he said, well, if you get an electric guitar, you can be in the Malibus. I convinced my parents that I would make back the money that it would cost them to buy me a guitar and an amp. And it was a Fender Strat, a brand new Fender Stratocaster. I started writing songs within the first year of having a guitar. I was inspired to write my first song by a terrible song called Leader of the Pack by the Shangri-Las. When I heard that on the radio, I thought, well, I can write something as good as that. And so that was the beginning, and I haven't stopped writing songs to this day, and that's many days that we've been through since then. I once was a fresh young kid, nothing could drag me down. I lived in a love what I did, no one could turn it round. I actually had an opportunity to play in the later versions of the Burrito Brothers, the Flying Burrito Brothers. And so I've been able to use those songs that I have written in that genre with that band. And then the Malibus was a surf band, and I love surf music, and we've done, I think, 5 surf records. Famously, the World's Fair in New York in 1965, we played at the New York State Pavilion, and we played at the RCA Pavilion. And we were seniors in high school at that point, or juniors in high school. And we were asked what type of music we did. And we said, we do everything from surf to English sound, because that was when the English invasion, the British invasion was happening. So after having done all these surf records, we got to do the English sound record, and we did that one last. It's called Queen's English. Isn't it just what we'd all like to do? have our cake and eat it too. To, as a songwriter, exercise all these different parts of me. Because I really think of myself as a songwriter first and foremost. After you've written songs, it's like, well, they don't exist unless someone sings them, and so I guess I'd better sing them. And so I enlisted myself to sing these songs.
Somebody said you were familiar yet innovative. What the devil does that mean?
Beats me. I don't know. Actually, I think it means that my music comes out of, like, basic rock and roll, so everybody can relate to it.
So I had an offer from a record label in England called United Artists to do three singles. And singles, for you youngsters, were songs that were only, one song on a side of a record, the vinyl record. I know vinyl is coming back. And the flip side was the B-side. So basically six, I had an opportunity to record six songs. And so we looked around for some producers, and lo and behold, because I happened to be working at a studio called Sound City, and Sound City now is famous because of Dave Grohl's documentary about it, another act had been working there named Fleetwood Mac. And Fleetwood Mac had just added a few players, namely a woman named Stevie Nicks and a guitar player named Lindsey Buckingham. And so they wanted to produce me. They produced my first album. Little did I know that Stevie was going to become the icon that she has become. But she is quite a charismatic lady. And in fact, during the recording of my first album called Fundamental Role, released on Columbia Records, 1977, Stevie was doing the background vocals in her inimitable way. I was inspired that night to write the song Magnet and Steel, and which became my big song somewhat later. Well, that was the first release from my second album, Not Shy. That was 1978. My success up to that point was a cut, as they say in the songwriting business, where someone records your song. There was a guy named Graham Parsons who was the godfather of Americana or alt country or whatever they call it now today. To many people, the fact that I had a cut from Graham Parsons outweighs the fact that I had a gold record and a million seller with my song Magnet and Steel. Or even for that matter, that Eminem used my song Hot Summer Nights for his song We Made You. Thought to myself, well, if I want to be a writer, I can be a writer no matter what I take. And so I became an art major, eventually doing metal sculpture, and it was a lot of fun. It was good. So I've been here at Centennial in January of 1998. The school was almost 2 years old at that point. And the way that I wound up here was, first of all, my son, who bears the same name as I, had enrolled in Franklin High. And he asked me not to sub in the same school where he went to school. And so I understood that, and I had some friends who were musicians and apparently were also teachers. There was a guy that used to teach here named Mr. Durio, and he invited me to come over and check it out, and so I did. I had actually started substitute teaching in California when I was living out there previously. So, and substituting works well for a musician because we can work when we want to and we can not work when we have gigs. I only sub Centennial for the last maybe 7 or 8 years now. The fact is I still do as much music as possible, and I still love performing, and I still write songs and record new songs. Every year I record a new album. at home.
After all these years, Walter Egan is still rocking out. I guess you could say, music is like the magnet, and he is the steel.